confirmed about the growing darkness in the Western Kingdoms. The Necromancer Zayl journeys to Westmarch to restore the balance.
And they displaced it across paths with Lady Selene and Sarda, the last heir to the ancient house that seeks the Necromancer to help proceed with their late husband.
I have returned, but as they summon Lord Nisarda's spirit in the moldering crypts beneath the family estate, Zayl and Selene stumble upon something unexpected. A sinister plot to unleash the demon Astrogha and his minions on Sanctuary.
While Selene and Zayl become entangled in a web of alliances and intrigues that embroil both the nobility and Selene's bloodline,
Astrogha's allies work to prepare her with his ritual to ensure his coming. The key to his return, the memory of the spider, is the heart of the manning evil in Westmarch. Who wields the malevolent artifact? And to what end?
21. Caribatus had not survived for more than a century by being unwilling or unable to adapt. He had clearly underestimated Astrogha's reach into the mortal plane from the demon's prison. A careless mistake, but one not insurmountable. The armored necromancer always considered other options in advance, and so he already knew what he had to do. If Astrogha desired Zayl's body, Caribatus would grant him that, for a time. In truth, no one knew a Rothmanian's strengths and weaknesses better than one of their own, and that fact worked to Caribatus' advantage. He had already laid a number of subtle spells upon the late Aldric Jitan that would have enabled him to cast out Astrogha when the world was in true balance. Variations of those could be cast upon Zayl. The younger necromancer's own protective spells and inherent power would mask them even better than the ones on Caribatus' aristocratic dupe. But he had to act fast. Invisible to the mortal eye, with the exception of a skilled spellcaster such as himself, was the work that the demon now did in preparation to taking Zayl. However, the demon was finding Zayl's resistance much greater than expected. Caribatus applauded his counterpart's able, if ultimately futile, defense. It proved the strength of Rothmanian training, and also bought him the time that he needed for his new spell work. The so-called children of Astrogha were simple to fool, little more than weak manifestations of the master demon, Caribatus concentrated. Besides, he would not need long to finish his work. He withdrew from his belt the ivory dagger taken from Zayl. Key to his plans. Another variation of the life tap would ensure that, when the time came, the spider demon would find his superior body even more fragile than the one for which he had abandoned it. But as the necromancer surreptitiously began his spells, he failed to notice the black pouch lying to the side. Had he noticed it, he might have seen how what seemed eye holes lay pressed against it. Eye holes focused in his direction. The legs pressed against Zayl's skull with such force that any moment he expected them to crush his head. Yet he knew that what would happen would be far more horrifying. Each of the appendages would bore through the bone until they buried deep inside the brain itself. There, they would meld with his mind. Once that happened, there would be only Astrogha, no more Zayl. But it would not end there. Astrogha would use the necromancer's learning, his abilities to enhance his own demonic powers. The secrets of the Rothmanians would be added to the spider's vast knowledge, and surely that would mean a far greater danger to the mortal plane. How could Caribatus let this happen? Zayl no longer believed that his counterpart had become a victim of his many battles against the darkness. No, the legendary Necromancer was simply mad. Not that knowing that was any comfort to Zayl. The insidious voice of Astrogha filled his mind again.
Can I answer that well, Lord Zayl? And you will become a god.
I will become nothing,
the Necromancer returned. Take what you must, but I will not give it to you. You cannot understand why the demon did not just possess him as he had Lord Jitan. Surely Zayl's skull was no thicker than the noble's. Was there more to it? Could it be that what Zayl knew, what gifts he had, the Necromancer had to surrender to the demon? Perhaps the Astrogha risked losing what he sought if he simply made Zayl an empty host, such as Jitan. So, perhaps there was one card still left to play. Now he understood why the Spire had worked around Caribitus to draw Zayl to him even before he was freed. After having fought and lost more than once against sorcerers like the Vajrai, Astrogha sought to ensure that he would never be defeated again. Zayl knew that he would rather become like Aldric Jitan than grant the demon's monstrous desire. He strengthened his will and felt Astrogha's anger when the latter realized that the Wrathmanian would not fall prey so readily. But Zayl hoped that Astrogha did not also realize that there was a limit to the human will. The Necromancer wanted his fiendish adversary to lose patience and slay him before he started to falter again. If Zayl's will began to fail, and Astrogha noticed, then the demon would surely triumph.
What you dream, you can have. Riches, power, and empire.
You mean you will have them?
I will not give to you what I did to a soul.
Astrogha sought to reassure him.
Do you not recall how my followers of old code, you, their master, share with me the secrets you hold, and I will share mine.
It was not the words themselves that were beguiling, for they were basic and blunt. However, woven into each syllable was another form of magic. A subtle one that burrowed into the unsuspecting mind the way a worm burrowed through a rotting corpse. Merely listening to Astrogha allowed that magic to penetrate one's thoughts, unless that one was skilled in deflecting such tricks as Zayl was. Yet again, even he had his limits, and they were approaching faster than the Wrathmanian desired. But other than continue to pray for death rather than possession, Zayl could think of nothing to do. There was no one there who could help him, either for there was only Humbert, who lacked even a full skeleton, much less mobility. If he was to perish though, Zayl took comfort in one thing. He had sent Selene back to the city. She would escape from there. At least, if he had failed in everything else, he had not failed in that. Surely, she was safe. He had fought many battles over the span of his career, and, at the moment, General Torian would have traded this monstrous struggle for the very worst of them. The best he could say of the situation was that his men were temporarily holding their own. Some reinforcements had arrived to back up those with him, but reports from the rest of the capital indicated that even when those sent by Justinian arrived, their numbers would not be great. Most of the soldiers Torian had originally expected were now needed elsewhere. It seemed that, at this point, the spiders were pouring over every wall. But that was not the worst of it. reports also filtered in concerning many defenders and even innocent civilians who now walk the capital as the living dead, their bodies mounts for the hideous arachnids. Several initial possessions had fallen because of soldiers' ignorance of the terrible fate besetting those whose heads were not covered sufficiently. Fortunately, thanks to Torion himself, word had quickly spread as to the danger. The spiders kept coming. For every one that was skewered on the end of a sword or burnt by oil and fire, there seemed a dozen more. Maybe even 100.
Where do they all come from?
The veteran commander wondered as he helped roll another barrel of oil forward. At least a fifth of the capital was either ablaze or had already been burnt. Even more of it would have been if not for the fact that the rain was growing stronger. It was necessary to fuel every blaze with oil or some other flammable liquid, but finding stockpiles was becoming more and more difficult. Several places where oil and such should have been stored had been emptied out previously. From what little had gleaned, the order to do so had been signed by Edmund Fairweather. Torion cursed the dead man constantly and hoped that his fiery demise had been long and painful, and even then it would have been too kind for the general's taste. Passing the barrel on to another soldier, Torion paused for a breath. Justinian, now back to his senses, had turned much of the coordination of the struggle over to his far more skilled and experienced commander. It was not vanity for General Torion to think that. Without him, the efforts to save everyone from this nightmare would not be nearly so organized. Of course, he was fortunate in that several of his top officers had so far managed to survive. Wherever possible, Torion had put one of them in charge. His one regret was that no one had seen Alec Matthias. There had been a message sent much earlier when capturing Zayl had been the only concern of the evening. That had said the commander intended to take a patrol and follow up a hunch beyond the city walls. Torion had resigned himself to the fact that the man he had once assumed would be his successor had likely perished out there, fighting to the last against the eight-legged fiends. Taking another deep breath, the general surveyed the vicinity. A line of archers worked steadily to send oil-soaked fire arrows wherever needed. They were defended by soldiers armed with swords, pikes, and naturally torches. To the north, and heading toward Torion, was a helmed figure that looked much like the missing Alec Matthias. The wary commander grinned. He started toward the captain. Alec, his expression dour, slowly saluted the older fighter. In his other hand, the adjutant held a well-used blade.
Alec, lad,
called Torion, forgetting military protocol. He was too happy to see his aide. With no sons of his own, he had secretly considered the captain the equivalent of one.
Where in the blazes have you been? Are you all right?
There was a silence. Then the approaching figure responded.
Yes, I am all right.
His voice had a monotone quality to it that did not surprise Torion. All the soldiers were exhausted, and Alec looked as if he had been dragged through the streets.
Well, I'm glad to see you, lad.
The general glanced back at where the men were moving the barrels. Out of the corner of his eye, Torion noticed the adjutant reaching toward him in an attempt to wrest away his helmet.